Hey, come on in. Get in here. Have a seat. There's nowhere to sit. Let's talk about 3D printers for a little bit. When it comes to finding a new 3D printer, I think it's a safe assumption to say that we all want that printer to produce beautiful 3D prints. Beyond that, the amount of emphasis that we put on different things like feature set, cost, brand recognition, or community support varies from person to person. I'm going to go over a 3D printer that I've been using for the past few weeks. I'm going to take you through the ups and downs, and you get to decide how strong my clickbait game is. And of course, I'll give you my thoughts on the 3D printer, and you can then give me yours in the comments. Or not, you could just watch the video, I don't know. In any case, it's going to be a good time, so come on, let's go. So Creality sent me their newest printer in the Ender series. Thank you very much. It's the Creality Ender 3 V3 KE. I'm not going to lie, I was really looking forward to getting this printer, so you can imagine my trepidation on the delivery day when the box came looking as if it had been dipped into the ocean. It was comically wet. It was literally dripping water. In case you're wondering, no, I don't blame Creality for this. I know it's a review unit, but I doubt they sent me a soggy printer out of their warehouse. I think it's probably more likely that the package got wet during transit. But I signed for it anyway, and I took the printer inside and started to set it up. While the juicy printer seems like we're off to a rough start, it was actually just the box that was well hydrated. It's actually kind of a testament to how well Creality packaged the printer, because all of the components felt dry to the touch while I was doing assembly, and spoiler alert, once the assembly was done, the printer powered on and ran fine, and I haven't had any water-related issues at all. So printer setup was not that difficult, it didn't take me very long. It definitely did not take me as long as it took me to set up my Ender 3 Pros or my CR10. And I found the instructions easy enough to follow. You just have to connect the frame with the X rail and the hot end into the base of the printer, secure it with a couple of screws, turn the whole unit on its side, and secure it with a couple more screws. And of course, there's a few cables that you need to plug in as well. And of course, you have to connect the screen, which is actually the Creality Nebula Pad. And that's going to be a factor here in just a second. But after I finished putting everything together and moving the printer to its new temporary home, I plugged it in and turned it on. There's a little setup wizard that you have to go through, and one of those steps is connecting to your Wi-Fi network so that you can bind your printer to the Creality Cloud, which is Creality's online service for finding paid and free 3D models. You can also use this service to send pre-sliced models directly to your 3D printer and it will just start printing them. However, I had to skip this step because the virtual keyboard that is on the touchscreen for the Ender 3 V3 KE does not have an underscore character, which means that I could not put in my now old Wi-Fi password. I have a lot more thoughts about that I want to go over, but first we're going to finish going through the printer setup part and then I'll come back. Overall, though, setup was pretty easy. I ran the equipment self-test, which took about 15 minutes. And during that time, the printer underwent its own little setup sequence, leveling the bed and doing Z-probing with the CR Touch. Once that was done, I used the filament sample that came in the box to run off the test benchy print, which came on a flash drive along with some user manuals for the printer. The benchy printed beautifully and did so in somewhere between 16 and 17 minutes, including the heat up time. One of the features of this printer is that it can print up to 500 millimeters per second with an acceleration rate of up to 8,000 millimeters per second squared. And the Benchy does look beautiful. Getting fast and beautiful prints out of your 3D printer is a job that's split up between your printer's parts and the firmware that drives them. The KE uses Creality OS, which is a version of the open source project Clipper, which is pre-configured to anticipate the vibrations that the KE is going to make while printing and offset them so that those vibrations don't end up in your print. Having open source at the core is one of my favorite, if not my favorite, thing about the Ender 3 V3 KE. It opens up a lot of options for the end user. Let's say I want to attach an accelerometer to the KE to send real-time movement data in order to more accurately offset those vibrations that happen during printing. Or let's say I have some webcam just laying around and I want to plug it into the printer so that I can have real-time monitoring of my prints. provided there's a way to attach those devices to the printer and there's a firmware that can use those devices, I can do that. I would just have to ensure that those devices are in fact supported by the firmware and then flash that firmware to the printer. If the thought of doing that doesn't jive with you, that's okay. There are official Creality supported versions of those devices that you could simply purchase and plug in with no extra steps required. My point is that no matter which direction you take, it's up to you. The end user gets to decide how to use their device. That is an idea that I care about a lot. Creality has recently released an update to the KE's firmware that allows the user to easily unlock root access for the printer. The firmware was easy to install. It's just moving a file onto the flash drive, plugging the flash drive into the printer, and then the printer prompted to install the update. But what's nice about having the root access is that this actually enables you to kind of sidestep that problem with the underscore character. The downside is you need to be somewhat familiar in the field of IT in order to make that happen. So it's a solution for some people, but still remains a problem for others. Initially, I was hoping that there would be a firmware release that puts the underscore key in the virtual keyboard. However, like I mentioned earlier, KE's touchscreen is actually the Creality Nebula Pad, which is its own standalone device, has its own firmware, and I don't believe that that is open source. So we're basically waiting on Creality to release an update for that firmware in order for the keyboard issue to be fixed. I had one other issue while testing this printer. That issue may or may not affect other people. I'll get into that as I continue to talk about the actual testing of the printer. So like I said, the Benchy came out beautiful. Other things that look beautiful are pretty much every other print that I've done using the Creality Slicer, Creality Print. I found the interface easy enough to understand. I've only really ever used Cura or Prusa Slicer, and I feel like this was kind of a blend of both. It was pretty simple overall. The slicing software comes with the KE's printer profile. It's already pre-tuned to give you what Creality deems to be the best possible print. And I am very happy with the quality of all of the prints so far. Creality Print also integrates the Creality Cloud right into the software so that you can find a model and prep it for printing all within one spot. If you're a 3D printing veteran, this probably is not too impressive with you, especially since the user interface is a little bit too simple. I'd say it's definitely lacking in the filter department. Personally, I know I'll still be using my usual sources for finding 3D models for printing. But if you're new to the hobby and just getting your feet wet, this little added benefit might make the getting started process just a little bit easier for you. Another thing that I want to just toss in there, and I'm kind of tacking it on because I found out about this a little bit late in the testing game, the KE actually also has a web interface. So once you've connected to your Wi-Fi network, you can go to the networks section on the LCD screen of the printer and get the printer's IP. If you punch that IP address into a web browser, you get a web interface which has management tools with the ability to start and stop and pause your prints. And that's a nice little feature. This same functionality is available within Creality Print, so you can control your printer right from that software. But the web interface is nice because you can just check on your print and control your printer from your mobile device, or maybe something like a spare tablet that you have laying around. There is one thing that I didn't really talk about when it comes to using the printer is the printer noise. It's the quietest printer that I own because all of my printers are incredibly noisy, but the KE has a silent motherboard, and so you can kind of hear the bed going back and forth, but the biggest noise is the blower fan. And I personally don't find that obtrusive. I printed a lot with PLA, pretty much nonstop for the first week that I had the printer. I also did test out TPU, ABS, and PETG. Yeah, that's right, I say PETG. Letters are meant to be read, not pronounced. I don't really want to fight about it. The KE does support a couple others, but the ones that I named before and tested out are the ones that most hobbyists are going to use most of the time. And even within that subset, I feel like it's mostly going to be PLA. The Ender 3 V3 KE is not an enclosed printer, and I did not use an enclosure when I printed with ABS. I did end up using a little bit of glue stick as an adhesive to keep the print on the build plate, but that's just kind of how that goes because ABS is one of those plastics that's a little bit tougher to print with. Print adhesion was made easier because of the KE's PEI flexible build plate, auto bed leveling, and Z probing, which comes in very handy. I don't watch the first layer of a print go down unless I just kind of want to. I otherwise had zero issues printing with any of those filaments. The printer can handle these filaments at the speeds that it does, in part because of the sprite-style direct drive extruder, ceramic heater, bimetal heat break and its longer style nozzle. I do want to clarify to anyone who's just not aware that you're not going to be printing all of your models at top speed. Different plastics need different things, like speed, cooling, and print and bed temperature. But those restrictions didn't stop me from seeing how much speed I could squeeze out of this printer. That was not my best move. Like I said, the Creality Print slicing software has its own printer profile for the KE, and those are the parameters that Creality feels the printer works best under. But if you say, tweak around with your own profile like I did, and tell it to go at max speed and acceleration at all times like I did, you're not going to get good results. Especially if you're not going to be printing at the proper temperature, like I didn't. The thing is, if you don't lay down a plastic with the proper speed and temperature, you're going to end up with very rough layers. If you continue to print like that, you're going to run the hot end over very rough layers. That hot end is going to get banged around a lot and take a lot of vibrations. In my case, when I did this, I managed to knock half of the hot end off of its mounting bracket. I stopped everything to take a look at the hot end, and in the end, everything was fine, and it is definitely my fault. I did notice, though, that the fasteners that are used to mount the hot end to its bracket are, in my opinion, a little on the short side. And take that with a grain of salt, because as a review unit, it's probable that this is an earlier iteration of this printer. I don't claim to be an expert in mechanical engineering or product design, and I'm not even sure that this is an issue. I just noticed that there was some extra thread space on the bracket for the hot end. I had longer machine screws laying around, so I just reinstalled the hot end with those, and I don't use that printer profile anymore, and now everything is fantastic. All right, let's get some final thoughts in here. Creality has asked me to weigh in on whether or not I feel this would be a good printer for a beginner to use. In all honesty, I don't really like that question, and we all look for different things. But if I think about a beginner user wanting a printer that's fairly easy to use in terms of assembly, finding 3D models, slicing those models, and then getting a good quality print with those models, and to do all of that easily, then I would say that the Creality Ender 3 V3 KE checks off a lot of those boxes. In fact, it checks off all of them if Creality fixes that underscore character on the virtual keyboard. That's going to knock out, I don't know how many people, but if you can't connect the printer to your Wi-Fi network, you won't be able to communicate with it through the slicer, the web interface, or your phone. Meaning that nice feature where you can just send a print right to your printer from the cloud isn't going to be available. If the Nebula Pad is shipping without an underscore character, it's kind of nice to know that this is something that could just be fixed with a firmware update, although obviously you don't want to have to do that in the first place. Now I do want to qualify this again with, this is a review unit. I'm not sure how these are going to be shipped out. It's quite possible that that problem is already fixed. Hey, it's me, Future Kyle. I'm actually editing the video right now, and I just wanted to chime in because I don't think that the issue is fixed quite yet. The Nebula Pad receives over-the-air firmware updates, and mine is connected to the internet, so it should update automatically. And right now, there's still no underscore character. At this time, the most recent update was December 11th of 23, so like a month and a half ago, and I believe that I am on that firmware. I did tell Creality about the underscore issue and my thoughts on those shorter hot end screws, and I'd like to think that there's a change in the works for that, but I don't know. If I hear anything, I will update in the video description. So provided a beginner user doesn't have an underscore in their Wi-Fi password, and if they stick to the Creality slicer, then I have no problem recommending this printer to basically anyone. Because the truth is, it does give you really good prints. It is very fast, and it is packed full of features. Features that you would expect to see in a very nice next-gen bedslinger printer in 2024. Other printers in the bedslinger class will be in the $400-ish dollar price point. Which is not bad. The Creality Ender 3 V3 KE retails for $299, which I think makes it a great value. The self-serviceability and moddability that comes with an open source core is something that really, really resonates with me. I get to decide what the lifespan of my printer is, and that gives me the warm and fuzzies on the inside. Feel free to join in on the conversation and drop a comment below. I am curious to know what you guys think. Do you think that the feature set that this printer offers makes it something that's worth considering when you're shopping around for a 3D printer? How bad is that missing underscore character? In any case, I look forward to reading your thoughts. If you enjoyed this video, please do like it and subscribe if you want to see more content like this. I post a lot on YouTube Shorts and TikTok, so if you're looking for shorter form content, you can follow me there. I really appreciate you sticking around to the end of the video. I am going to leave a link to the Ender 3 V3 KE in the video description. It is not an affiliate link, but if you want to check out the printer, I'd appreciate it if you used it. It will let me know that I've sent you Creality's way. Otherwise, thanks for sticking around. Have a good day, and I'll see you in the next video.